Hey everyone, how's it going? I know I've talked about Sonic on this channel a handful of times already, and I know I've used Sonic footage in some of my editorials that didn't require any specific game footage. Hopefully you guys don't find yet another video about Sonic using Sonic footage tiring or annoying, and hopefully the fact that this is going to be more of a detailed, design-oriented video will make up for that fact if you do find the repetition kind of obnoxious. I just really wanted to do one of said more design-oriented editorials. And this topic is one that I've been really interested in doing lately, what with one of the recent Grumpcade series being Sonic 3 and Knuckles, played by The Completionist, and with a new video by the channel known as Good Blood going somewhat viral. This video, titled Dear Sega, Sonic Redesign, was one that I found pretty interesting because it really makes you think about the Sonic games on a multitude of different levels you might not have before. Link to it, as always, is in the description. Anyway, that video also inadvertently made me realize that I've been relaying my thoughts on Sonic's design in a somewhat inefficient way. To some extent, I've been doing it a disservice. Using just one word, I can explain why Sonic's classic design works in a way that's infinitely better than I could before. That one word is flow. Yes, Sonic's classic gameplay is about momentum. And yes, Sonic's design relies on a complex physics system. But more than that, it's about flow. Speed is really only achievable when you can find an adequate flow line through the stages. Realizing this not only gives you a better understanding of how well designed these classic games actually are, but it also illustrates just how different the newer games are in concept. Honestly, the Grumpcade series made me interested in doing this video mostly because of how Aaron views the series. I'm gonna link him to this editorial in the hopes that he checks it out. If he doesn't, then that's how it goes, I suppose. If he is watching though, then hey, what's up, Aaron? Hopefully this video encourages you to give some of the Sonic games a try from a different perspective. And that's really what the intention of this video is. I want people like Aaron who find it difficult to enjoy the Sonic games to feel like they want to pick one of them up again and maybe try it once more. Of course, not everyone will like them. I understand that. But I can't help but feel that this is all too often because they're expecting something they aren't getting. They're trying to fit a playstyle from a different type of game into Sonic without even realizing it. If we jump straight to the point, most of the time, that playstyle is what we'll call the Mario playstyle. People are playing Sonic as if it's to be played like a regular platformer. Unlike games like Mega Man X or Metroid, Sonic doesn't come off as distinct from Mario at the outset. Those games immediately showcase just how different they are, whereas Sonic takes a bit of dissecting before you realize that it's using a lot of unique design techniques. Note that I won't be showing any Mario or Metroid gameplay for comparison's sake, since I don't want the Nintendo police coming after me, even though it's illegal for them to effectively extort people and steal their profits when they're doing critical review and comparison of their products using brief examples. Anyway, because Sonic's gameplay appears the same on the surface, people tend to subconsciously try and play it the same way. They perform actions that they would in Mario, and get upset when this doesn't give them the results they desire. To some extent, this could be leveled as a criticism of the first level of each Sonic game. After all, these levels are there to teach the player how to play the game, right? Well, yes, they are, and they actually do a great job of it. If you really pay attention to the construction of Green Hill Zone, Emerald Hill Zone, Angel Island Zone, etc., you'll see that these levels have a heavy emphasis on simple platform-to-platform connections. These levels are structured in a way that allows you to practically always keep moving forward with only minimal effort. The only time these levels slow you down is when they're attempting to get you to learn something new. The rest of the time, these initial stages are set up to basically allow players to hold left and occasionally jump. Green Hill Zone, as the first level in the series, actually does a fantastic job of showing the player nearly all of the core design pieces of the game within the first zone, and allowing them to easily interact with it all. Let's break it down. So at the very beginning, there's a long stretch of straight ground, which reveals that Sonic doesn't start at a high speed. He accelerates as he moves forward. Pretty simple. Shortly after, you'll come across your first set of rings floating above you. Grabbing these rings both teaches you the jump command, and reveals that these are collectibles placed throughout the game. Right after this is another place to jump, in the form of a ledge with a strange box on it. Since the box has a picture of a ring on it, one can only assume that it's a power-up. Hitting it gives you 10 rings. Note that this also reveals to you that Sonic games have selective collision detection with certain platforms. The bottom of a platform can often be jumped through. It also shows you that there are different paths you can take, which we'll get to a bit later. If you're on that top platform, your first ground enemy will skate right by you. If you decided not to jump to the platform above, then you're likely going to be going so fast that you'll get hit by him your first time. But that's okay. This is the game's way of teaching the player that they can take damage as many times as they want, as long as they have rings. If you're on the top path though, most players will jump off at the end. Doing so reveals several new things in quick succession. You'll see your first flying enemy go by, showing you that there are many types of robotic obstacles ahead of you. When you jump, you're almost always guaranteed to land on the hidden yellow spring in the tree ahead, teaching you about springs and showing you that there are secret areas that you won't always be able to see, so exploration is important. When you land, you'll be in front of a bridge where, if they haven't already, players are almost guaranteed to learn the lesson about taking damage and recollecting rings. Right past this bridge comes your first downhill section that will speed you up, immediately followed by one of the game's signature curved ramps. When you hit this ramp, Sonic will get air. He won't stop moving, but instead his momentum changes directions thanks to the ramp. Still further ahead, you've got a few little stairs that stop you in your tracks. If you didn't already, you'll see the crab enemies ahead, which attempts to make you realize that simply holding forward the whole time won't allow you to best every obstacle. The rings above the solid rock ahead of you tell you that some other objects can be solid, and ring placement often denotes the smoothest path you can take. The flying enemy ahead is much more dangerous this time than he was the first time. Assuming you took the high path in the beginning, he just sort of whizzes right by you. But here, you'll probably be stopped by the cliff ahead. This gives him time to catch up and shoot a projectile at you, further teaching you about the obstacle variety in store for you. Keep in mind, of course, that at any time during these first few enemies, panic jumping allows the player to learn that Sonic kills enemies when he's in ball form, which includes when he jumps into them. And again, in case you missed the hidden yellow spring at the beginning, there's one right in front of you here, which all but guarantees you'll learn their mechanics. Landing on the platform across the gap shows you that some ground is unstable. If you make it to safety ahead, you're good. If you panic and fall with the platform, you're still good. The game is trying to ease you into the idea that there are always multiple paths to take. Next, your first checkpoint is ahead, and above that are floating platforms, further incentivizing exploration and rewarding it with a ring box. You're then taught about another type of floating platforms that fall, and shown a glimpse of a loop below. Meanwhile, if you missed that first falling platform and landed below, you'll get to experience this loop firsthand. The stage continues on just a bit further before ending with the downhill section into the signpost that ends the zone. In all likelihood, the player didn't get hit enough to have less than 50 rings, revealing a giant ring ahead. Naturally, they'll jump into it and enter the first special stage, which is also pretty well tutorialized. So what all did we learn across this zone? Acceleration, rings, taking damage, power-ups, enemies, different enemy types, how to defeat enemies, collapsing platforms, springs, inclines and declines, ramps, momentum, checkpoints, loops, secrets, special stages. We learned a lot. The only thing it didn't necessarily directly teach you was that holding down causes Sonic to roll up into a ball. But even then, the chance of the player not doing this before the zone is over is honestly really low. Again, it's important to note that the game teaches you all of this without slowing the player down more than once or twice, but they can also take it at their own pace. Further zones have a much heavier emphasis on the speed you can get through ramps and such, really showcasing the importance of flow. I know, of course, that the second area in Sonic 1, Marble Zone, slows things down a lot. This can be seen as a negative, since there isn't a lot of flow to be found here, and I do kind of see this as a mistake. If the stage was simply difficult to flow through, it'd make sense. But instead, it's all but impossible. I think what they were trying to show is that Sonic isn't all about speed. They were trying to get players to realize that Sonic's gameplay is multifaceted, and isn't always as simple as the first area may have made them believe. There's a lot of nuance in Sonic's gameplay. The series isn't full of overcomplicated enemies or platforming, specifically because that would stop flow. It's all about using small, precise actions to keep the gameplay going, rather than presenting big challenges like most platformers. To compare, let's look at a quick mock-up of a slice of Mario level design, and then compare it to a mock-up of Sonic level design. Note that both of these examples use design commonly seen in both games. They also are intended to be in the middle of the stage, implying that the player is currently moving smoothly into it, rather than starting from a dead stop as if they're at the beginning. So here we have the base level design in a Mario game. Pretty simple, honestly. Now we add both the start and end points, with Mario represented by the blue circles. No, I'm not trying to be manipulative by reinforcing Sonic-esque imagery in the Mario example. These things are going to get complicated quickly, so using simple shapes and distinct colors was important. If you have that much of a problem with it, pretend that I'm trying to manipulate you into liking Mega Man more or something. Anyway, next up comes the interactable objects in the stage, from coins and coin blocks to usable pipes and hidden items. Finally, as far as the stage itself goes, we have the actual obstacles and hazards. Notice the red lines at the bottom of the pits, which are the kill planes, and also note the piranha plant hiding in the pipe. Now, here's where we begin to break down Mario's choice in actions. First, we'll add the intended, straightforward pathway through this section of stage. Follow the pink arrows, and you'll see where the designers intended most first-time players to go. Pretty simple, right? Now let's add in the optional pathways the game has built in, shown by these darker arrows. Notice that taking a different path may lead Mario to different bonuses, but all of them end with him at the same spot at the other end of the stage. This is an important distinction from Sonic level design, which we'll take a look at right now. Again, here's the basic layout of the stage. It's got swinging platforms above, a swinging rope a little further ahead, and a platform that travels up and down directly below the rope. Next, we'll add Sonic's starting and ending points. Notice that the word points was plural. Sonic games thrive on having a multitude of pathways through each level that can all intersect across the entire stage. This is a pretty simple example, honestly, with real Sonic level design getting a lot more complex. Again, this is specifically set up to keep the player going even when they make a mistake. Punishment isn't always dealt through damage or death, but rather it's often in the form of falling from the path you wanted to be on. Here we see the interactable objects added in, like rings, springs, power-up boxes, and a special stage ring. One thing to note here is that, while early 2D Mario did indeed occasionally use coins to guide players, Sonic's design makes this a vital part of the levels. When you're traveling as fast as you can sometimes go in Sonic levels, a line of rings above the player can easily tell them to jump, for example, while they still have time to react. Even the color is a distinct golden yellow so that it really stands out from basically every stage in the series. Anyway, next are the stage hazards. Here's where things get really intricate. Let's add in the optimal routes and go through each of the three pathways as well while we're at it. Now, if you look at the top path, the position of the flying enemies near the big group of rings and the number of enemies is a significant but subtle design choice to influence the player's actions. The fact that the enemies are near the rings means the player is almost guaranteed to jump into them to get the rings. Since Sonic kills enemies he jumps into, he's safe in doing so. With three enemies in a row, Sonic will inevitably be slowed down to a predictable amount if he destroys even just two of the enemies. This is intentional, as a way to give the player just enough time to realize that the platforms ahead swing back and forth. With design like this, the swinging platforms in question will most likely be independent from the global timer. Certain things in Sonic games technically start moving as soon as the level timer starts. So for example, a platform that goes up and down might be exactly at the top of its movement at every fifth second. Though these level pieces technically don't exist until you get close to them, they're always consistently where they're supposed to be when you do get to them because of the global timer. However, some objects only start moving once they actually pop into existence. These ones are independent from the global timer. So by making the player want to jump and collect the rings above, they've made them hit these flying enemies. And by making them hit the flying enemies, they've also slowed them down, giving the non-global platforms just enough time to pop into existence and get into position. The rings after these swinging platforms once again tell the player to jump, where they'll see the swinging rope, grab onto it, and jump off at the top of its arc, then hitting the spring to the other end of the section. Now taking a look below at the fish enemies jumping out of the waterfall, you'll see that they're set up to be used as perfectly timed platforms across the gap, and the ramp before them alters Sonic's momentum to be more vertical, slowing down his forward momentum just enough to perfectly land on the first fish, before moving to the next, and then finally dropping right onto the opposite ramp without missing a beat. They'll then gain speed down the slope and through the loop, all but ensuring that they'll have the right arc to land on the other ramp and out the other side. Finally, we have the bottom path, which starts with a simple drop-off with a spring below. Having the spring here not only notes that the player wants to maintain a certain speed ahead, but also tells them how much speed they want, thanks to the color of the spring. In case some of you don't know, yellow springs are less powerful than red springs, which accelerate Sonic much harder. Anyway, once again, the rings ahead tell Sonic to jump. Notice that I put the spikes on the ceiling inside the environment. I was trying to imply that these spikes in this section shoot in and out of the ground every other second. So the first and third set of rings will advise the player to jump, even if the spikes are currently hidden in the ground, with the second set telling them not to jump again too early, or risk running into the spikes on the ceiling. Finally, you have a vertical spring that sends them upwards and off the other end of the bottom section. Notice, by the way, that the pathways get less complex as you go further down. The top path in Sonic games is generally the most rewarding, but it's also often the most difficult to maintain, with the bottom pathway being the opposite 9 times out of 10. So finally, here's where Sonic's gameplay really begins to diverge from Mario's. With so many paths to choose from, players have a multitude of combinations they can take. Nearly every point where the player can quote-unquote fail an obstacle allows them to seamlessly transition into another pathway, keeping them moving. Even beyond that, sometimes the player might just choose to alter how they traverse a certain section, which can enable them to get access to other paths that they wouldn't have access to otherwise. If we go back to the Mario example, you'll likely notice an even bigger difference besides Sonic's emphasis on flow and multiple pathways. You'll see a fundamental difference between how players think when they play both of these respective series. When playing Mario, one looks at each stage hazard as a separate challenge most of the time, unless said hazards are directly playing off of each other. Mario's stages are treated more like a series of singular puzzles put out in front of the player for them to solve. And nearly all players, but the best of the best, break these stages into small segments. They'll figure out how to get past the piranha plant and the Goomba, then they'll decide whether to explore around the warp pipe and the block hiding the vine, or if they just want to press forward. They'll then deal with the two tiny platforms, the first Koopa and the second Goomba, and the overhead blocks next. After that comes the Bullet Bill shooter and the stairs with the two other Koopas. Each of these sections is individualized, and usually taken fairly slowly compared to Sonic's stage, where the players will meld each section together thanks to the level design. If you look at the Sonic example, there are definitely three vertical slices of the stage you can break it down into, but while you're playing the game, you don't see them as separate. Instead, players internalize everything happening on screen at once, and are always looking ahead for the next thing to help them maintain flow. Again, this means that everything the game throws at you has to have a simple purpose, rather than being complex and super difficult to deal with. It's kind of like the difference between Dark Souls and Devil May Cry. DMC wants you to look at a whole pack of enemies, and dispatch all of them as quickly as possible. As such, most enemy types are extremely simple and don't take a lot of skill to defeat on their own. The strategy is in dealing with them as a whole, not the individuals. Dark Souls, meanwhile, makes each encounter an ordeal, forcing players to think strategically for each enemy. Neither design is better than the other, but they both offer something unique and interesting in their own ways. Sonic's gameplay is honestly very similar in execution to a Tony Hawk game. When one plays Tony Hawk, they're always trying to combo one trick into the next. They use manuals, grinds, spine transfers, and tons of other techniques as a way to keep things going. You're always looking ahead in Tony Hawk. The tricks you're doing when you're playing aren't important to any but the most skilled players. Instead, what's important is finding another object to do a trick, any trick, off of. If you want a better analog in the form of another platformer, compare Sonic's gameplay to that of Mirror's Edge. Both games are platformers centered around finding the smoothest path through a level. The focus is on looking at pieces of a level as if they're in tandem with one another, rather than taking each challenge on separately. You run up a wall, pull a 180, jump off the wall, land on a roof, slide under a vent, leap out and swing from a set of horizontal flagpoles. It's all about trying to link things together so that you never stop moving. Sonic's 2D gameplay is all about looking at sections of stages as a whole too. You look at curves, ramps, enemies, etc. as tools used to maintain your momentum, and therefore maintain your flow. Classic Sonic games don't simply offer up speed. Players create speed through quick thinking and ingenuity by combining the level design and stage hazards into a single cohesive package, a string of interactive pieces used for traversal. And you know, Sonic's flow isn't relegated to constantly going faster and faster. To steal a phrase from auto racing, slow in, fast out is sometimes the better option. When you're racing a 900 horsepower Le Mans car around a twisting, undulating track, it's more important that you hit turns correctly because you make up the most time on straights. The earlier you can accelerate out of a turn, the higher speeds you'll reach, and the longer you'll spend at said higher speeds until you have to brake for the next turn. This means you're going to be going faster overall. Plus, it allows you to better ensure that you're taking the correct lines through the turns so that you don't upset the vehicle's balance. It's the same idea here. Sometimes in Sonic, precisely hitting a slope at the right angle, or jumping at the right time, or slowing down and lining yourself up to combo some enemies is better than just holding right on the D-pad. Sometimes holding left for a bit to slow your roll allows for a better line. Playing Sonic is simple, mastering Sonic is difficult. Sonic's controls are therefore simple enough to accommodate such potentially complex and fast gameplay, but also to accommodate new players. You run, you jump, you roll, and you spin dash. All of these actions are performed with nothing more than pressing a direction on the D-pad, pressing the only command button, the jump button, or a combination of the two. Sonic's spin dash is honestly the most complex base mechanic, and it requires simply holding down and tapping the jump button. But it's super effective as well, because it allows Sonic to kill enemies and gives him an immediate speed boost to widen the options the player has. Every extra piece to Sonic's gameplay beyond this, like shield attacks in Sonic 3, is used to do nothing more than modify your abilities to give you more options without really making things more complex. Every one of the shield attacks is executable simply by pressing the jump button in the air. This technique can even be used when Sonic doesn't have a shield, as a way to deflect projectiles, and to protect Sonic from damage if the player is skilled enough. Honestly, I've always been struck by how consistent Sonic's 2D design is, particularly in Sonic 2 and later. Said shields in Sonic 3 have both passive usages as well as the jump modifiers too. The fire shield makes you immune to fire. The bubble shield lets you breathe underwater. The lightning shield attracts rings. Plus, the fire and lightning shields are even disabled if you touch water. This further gives the player reason to fine-tune their skills and root through levels if they, say, want to maintain having a lightning shield through Hydrosity Zone. On top of that, all the shields automatically reflect most minor projectiles. Marble Garden Zone has those blue booster things that you use the spin dash to create platforms with. The pinball plunger-like springs and the flippers in Casino Night Zone use both holding and tapping the jump button respectively to control them. The balloons in Carnival Night Zone, meanwhile, can both be bounced off of simply by landing on them and can release air bubbles to refill your breath when underwater. Everything in Sonic's 2D design is cohesive. There's really nothing that requires a particularly complex action that takes up a bunch of time or feels unnatural. It's all using a single button and a D-pad, and it's all designed to give the player more options to keep the flow of the gameplay going. Rings also have both a secondary and a tertiary purpose built in that further expands the mechanical depth of the game without adding something completely new to do so. Not only do rings allow you to turn into Super and Hypersonic when he's got all of the Chaos Emeralds, but they grant him entry into the special stages where he gets the Emeralds in the first place. Hell, even the special stages maintain the usage of Sonic's base gameplay mechanics. Check each of the different types of special stages out sometime, and reflect on how you're still almost always running, jumping, and trying to maintain a sense of flow throughout each stage. I was gonna take the time to further break down how this all compares to the modern Sonic games, and why, while many of these games are pretty well made given the time periods they were made in, ultimately Sonic Team struggles to give most of the 3D games much depth, because they focus too much on speed. Therefore, a lot of these games become far too complex, have fundamentally flawed design, and come out in laughably unfinished states. But I think I'll save that for another time. As I said in one of my earlier videos, it's unfair to judge Sonic's design as if it's supposed to be all about speed. Just because Sonic himself is about speed doesn't mean his gameplay is, or even needs to be. That's like saying Mario's gameplay is poor because he's an Italian plumber, yet his gameplay has nothing to do with plumbing in Italy. Good players will find flow in Sonic's gameplay all over the place. They're almost never not moving forward. Less skilled players might struggle to keep moving through the stages as quickly and easily, but they're always given different options and ways of learning the mechanics better. The stage structure offers a lot of replay value, as does the later inclusion of multiple characters with unique, but again, really simple, abilities and nuances. I think people in the end tend to dislike Sonic's gameplay because it requires unlearning habits they've accrued over time. Much like both the Souls games and Sim Racers do the same thing. People try to force Mario-like thought processes and actions into the game, and struggle to find speed this way. And since Sonic's marketing is all about speed, they see this as a fundamental failure on the game's part, when really it's just asking for a different skill set than we're used to using. It's never as simple as hold right and go fast. Also, I think a lot of people dislike Sonic because parts of the fanbase are kind of obnoxious and spend a lot of time disrespecting the series as well as anyone who disagrees with them.
Hi, this is my original Sonic OC named Sirixion the Hedgehog / Echidna Hybrid. He's from another world where hedgehogs and echidnas have become one. So he naturally has all of Silver's psychic powers and he's faster than Sonic. Kinda looks like Shadow, but he's way cooler, and he has all of Knuckles' abilities as well. He can also go into Omega Hyper Mode without any Chaos Emeralds. This makes him even stronger than Goku in Super Saiyan God form. When Sirixion shows up, he immediately kills Eggman, so Amy realizes that she actually loves him, as does Sally Acorn. But he thinks they're annoying. He doesn't like girls right now because his family was killed by Anti-Eggman on his planet. He was able to survive, but not without the battle leaving a scar across his face. So now Sirixion is searching for revenge and doesn't have time for girls. He also has a fun side though, but he really only shows that to Espio the Chameleon because they're best friends. He has a really cool jacket, his hair / spike covers his right eye, and he likes listening to Blood on the Dance Floor. This is my original character and I did not trace it, so do not steal. Tell me what you guys thought about this video, as well as Sirixion the Hedgehog / Echidna. If you liked this video, subscribe and leave a like. See you next time. Thank you.